Hello students, we are into experiment 2. The title of this experiment is Voltage Series Feedback Amplifier. Here is the disclaimer. So this is the outline that we are going to follow. So here is the block representation of Voltage Series Feedback Amplifier. So you can make out there are two things involved here. One is the sampling point. Okay, here this is the sampling. And here this is a mixing point or simply a comparator. Now in case of a voltage series, a part of the output signal, so here when I say a part of the output signal, it is a voltage which is sampled and which is connected back with a feedback fraction. Amount of the feedback is controlled by this value of beta. Now here you see it is connected in series. So this topology is referred to as voltage series feedback. So when any increase in the output signal results into the input in such a way as to, you know, cause the decrease in the output signal, the amplifier is said to have a negative feedback. Now the advantages of providing negative feedback are that the transfer gain of the amplifier with feedback can be stabilized against the variations in the hybrid parameters of the transistor or the parameters of the other active devices used in the circuit. Now the most advantage of the negative feedback is that by proper use of this, there is a significant improvement in the frequency response and in the linearity of the operation of the amplifier. Although this offers certain disadvantages, it includes the voltage gain. You see here, by employing a negative feedback, the voltage gain is decreased. Now in case of voltage series feedback, the input impedance of the amplifier is increased and the output impedance is decreased. Also the noise and the distortions are reduced considerably, and the common collector or this emitter follower is as shown in the figure. It's an example of voltage series feedback, since the voltage developed in the output is in series with the input voltage as far as the base emitter junction is concerned. So you can make out here the output is taken from the emitter as far as the emitter follower is concerned. So the signal is going to drop across this resistor, the output voltage, which also acts as a feedback voltage with respect to base emitter junction. Now this is a single stage RC coupled amplifier without emitter bypass collector across RE. R1 and R2 provides the base bias. The emitter follower inherently exhibits 100% negative feedback, since the voltage at the emitter follows the input voltage. And using the demonstration videos, we can actually make out this. Now you see here in this circuit, the output voltage is taken across RE. Or if I look from this end, this acts as a load resistance, so I can say RE equals to RL, and the feedback ratio beta equals to RE by RL. Now here they cancel out each other, so beta equals to 1. So if I talk about the overall voltage gain with feedback, the equation is AF equals to A upon 1 plus A beta, so beta equals to 1, so the equation reduces to A upon 1 plus A, so which is little less than the unity. And then there are certain characteristics of an emitter follower. As far as current gain is concerned, AI equals to 1 plus HFE. Will not derive this again in the practical session because we have already derived this in the classes, so you can again refer to those lectures available online. And then input resistance here equals to HIE plus 1 plus HFE into RL. Voltage gain is AI RL upon RI, which equals to 1 minus HIE by RI, and R naught equals to HIE plus RS divided by 1 plus HFE, and R naught F, that is the feedback, the output resistance with feedback, equals to R naught in parallel with RL. These are the different combinations, like we have voltage series feedback, voltage shunt feedback, current series feedback, and a current shunt feedback. Now this series of feedback connections tends to increase the input resistance, while the shunt feedback connections tends to decrease the input resistance. Also, the voltage feedback tends to decrease the output resistance, while the current feedback tends to increase the output resistance. So you can make out from this table, it is desirable that most cascade amplifiers need to have higher input resistance and lower output resistance. Now this voltage series type of feedback has the high input resistance, low output resistance. Now why do we have, you know, low input resistance to begin with for this transistor? Now you see, the signal is applied to the base and base emitter junction is forward biased, so the resistance, the input resistance offered by a transistor is low. Now it is desired to increase the input resistance, so we connect it in a voltage series fashion. So the moment we connect the circuit in voltage series feedback amplifier topology, the input impedance increases heavily, and that is what is desired if we have to, you know, work with the very signals of a very low magnitude or weak signals. On the other hand, the current shunt feedback has the least desirable effect, since it decreases the input resistance and increases the output resistance. So overall, this is a comparative study. I hope this is clear to all. Now the aim of this experiment is to verify the input output waveforms of voltage series feedback amplifier and to observe the voltage gain of the same. Here again are the components required. So you see, this circuit is similar to what we have studied in the first experiment. The only difference, if you observe, is that in the first experiment, that is current series feedback amplifier, the output was taken from the collector terminal. Here the signal is output is taken from the emitter terminal. So this circuit is a common collector circuit, and it is referred to as emitter follower because the output follows the input. So we are going to get the same signal at the output. Then again, that's the very same fundamental question: why are we using this? The simple reason is this particular circuit, that is emitter follower, has got very high input impedance and very low output impedance, that is desired. So here is the circuit diagram. These are the component values. When we work with any amplifier circuit, first you make sure that your transistor is working. You have to check out its base terminals voltages and its HFE value. Next, you have to mount the circuit properly with component values of R3, R2, R4 and R1. So this is your biasing network, and you have to note down what is the output voltage and the output current IC. So once this circuit is working perfectly, okay, then only you apply the test signal of 1 kHz and an input voltage of 10 millivolts or 20 millivolts. Now, when you check the voltage across VCE, it should be typically half of your VCC. If the VCC is 12 volt, we should primarily get here output voltage is 6 volt, and that will ensure that the cue point is right at the center of the DC load line. If once this is working, you have to apply a signal of 1 kHz and 20 millivolts. This is a test signal, and if all the connections are properly done, you will get the output to be observed on the CRO. Now you see here a capacitor has been connected. This is the bypass capacitor which is connected across this emitter resistance. Now if I close this switch, then the feedback ceases to exist, and if I open the switch, then there exists a feedback. Fine. These capacitors are used to block the DC components and to pass only the pro AC signal. So what all we required here to perform this experiment, these are the components. Then we do require CRO. Then this signal is derived from function generator, you require a power supply which can give us a voltage of 12 volts. Fine, this is all about the circuit diagram. Here is the theory. You can pause this screen and you can go through it. Then, as far as the bandwidth is concerned, it is plotted from 3 dB down from the maximum gain. So, if this is the frequency response, it will vary from 100 Hz to 1 MHz, and this is the plot what you are going to get. This is referred to as mid-band gain. Now, typically what we expect theoretically is that you should get something like this, meaning all the frequency components, meaning signal of all the frequencies should be equally amplified. This is a plot of gain 20 log of V0 by Vi. So Vi is kept constant, and if I vary the frequency from 100 Hz to say 1 MHz, I should get almost the same output for a given a fixed input. But that is not the case. You see here, initially when the frequency is, if I take condition here, if the frequency is 0, then when the frequency is 0, that means it's a DC voltage. So this DC signal will be passing through this wire. So the very first element or the component that will present here is the capacitor. So capacitor has got the resistance, which is referred to as reactance, given as XC equals to 1 upon 2 pi FC. Frequency, since I register DC voltage, frequency is 0. So the reactance, that is the resistance offered by the capacitor, will be infinite. So there is no chance of, you know, signal crossing the other side of the capacitor. Fine. So if no signal is reaching at the base, so naturally you won't have any output. So you will have a zero output for a DC voltage, irrespective of your magnitude. The magnitude can be 10 millivolts, but your frequency, if it is zero, then there won't be any signal reaching at the base terminal of the transistor. So there won't be any current activity here. Now, as I keep on increasing the frequency, right from say 100 Hz to 1 MHz, and you have to use steps 1, 2, 5, 7, meaning on the function generator, set first the frequency to 100 Hz, input voltage to 20 millivolts, note down the output voltage. Then make it to 200 Hz, 500 Hz, 700 Hz, then 1K, 2K, 5K, 7K, 10K, and so on. Fine. So as to cover the entire profile of the frequency response. Now, as the frequency increases, the reactance offered by the capacitor will reduce, and at certain point your entire signal will be available at the base, that is towards the midband. And at very high frequencies, the frequency roll off do take place, and again there are junction capacitances. The output resistance with feedback decreases by a factor of 1 plus AV beta, and the input resistance with feedback increases by a factor RI into 1 plus AV beta. So each topology is going to offer me a separate set of input and output resistances. So you can pause this slide and you can go through it. The most important is when we mount a circuit, we have to see to it that the connections are made proper. So there has to be a continuity between the circuit components. Fine. So you can go through it. The important point is the fifth one. Keep the input voltage constant at 20 millivolts peak to peak. This is using a function generator. This is the observations table. These are the model waveforms. The blue, what you see, is the input signal. Red is the output voltage. These are the precautions to be taken. So while taking the observations for the frequency response, the input voltage must be maintained at constant value of 20 millivolts. Now, so here are the results. After watching the demonstration video, you have to write the conclusion yourself. So what you have observed, and you can download the experimental write-up from this provided link. And now we will move on to the demonstration video.
Today we will learn how to use a breadboard. Okay, now we'll see how these breadboard connections are. Okay, all these vertical connections are, see, if you, what you do is that you take a multimeter, put in continuity mode, Okay, and what I've done is that I have connected wires to this probe so that the wires go inside the breadboard. See, these vertical lines which are there are connected. So all these vertical lines are actually shorted. There is a metal plate inside this vertical lines. Okay, so if you use a multimeter and check the continuity, it will give you a beep sound. Okay, so again I am trying for some other vertical lines. See here. See, all these vertical lines are shorted, so you can mount any of the components as per your wish. So all these vertical lines which you can see, they are shorted from here to here. You can check any of these vertical lines. Okay, they are shorted. Now now these horizontal lines, you know, now we have two horizontal lines here. Okay, but they are actually not shorted. Now actually the breadboard is divided into two parts, so from here to this last portion it is shorted. Okay, so you can connect your component to any of these slots. Okay, it is like this full line from here till here is shorted. Okay, so you can hear the beep sound. Okay, but this is, so we have a metal plate from here to here, that is the reason it is shorted, and then we have one more metal plate from this portion to this portion. Okay, so if I use a multimeter or connect one side to one this, okay, if you'll see that it is showing a continuity test. Okay, so it is showing a beep sound. Okay, so this part also is shorted. Similarly, this line also. Okay, there is no connection between the top line and the line below. Okay, there is no connection. See, there is no sound. Okay, no continuity sound. Okay, so there is no continuity here. Okay, so as per this horizontal line, from here till here it is shorted. From here till here it is shorted, and on the other side from here to here it is shorted, and from here to here. I'll show you for the last time. See, from here to here it is shorted. Okay, then this is one line, this is second line that is shorted. Okay, and then this is the third line that is shorted, and this is the fourth line that is shorted. Okay, and all these vertical lines are shorted. Okay, see, like this. Okay, but this vertical line and this vertical line is not shorted. Okay, see here, it is not giving you a beep sound. Okay, so none of these vertical lines are shorted, this and this. Okay, see, if I connect here and here, you will not get a vertical beep sound. Okay, but if you connect like this, you will get a beep sound. So this is how you should use a breadboard. Okay, yes, thank you. We'll see how to use a power supply. So for all our circuits we have a battery in the circuit diagram, but using battery will be costly for us. So usually what we do is that we have a power supply. So this is a DC power supply, okay, that we have over here. Okay, and I'll teach you all how to use this. Okay, so we have three different sections over here. So these two points, this is positive and negative of the power supply. This is one section wherein you can get a variable voltage from 0 to 30 volts in this, using these two points. Okay, this is the positive, this is the negative. You can see here there is a positive here. Okay, there is a positive here, and you can see that there is a negative sign here. So this is positive and negative, and it is showing that it is variable. So you can get any voltage from 0 to 30 volts. Now how do you set this voltage? Using these two knobs over here. This is coarse, where you can change the voltage abruptly fast. Okay, and if you want to adjust it very slowly, you can use this fine knob over here to set the current. We have this knob over here, I maximum. Okay, so using these three knobs I can actually set this voltage. Okay, so you can vary it from anything from 0 to 30 volts. So in the second part we have over here, it is having a fixed 5 volts power supply, power section. So this is positive, this is negative. Now it is not variable, this is fixed. Okay, so you will always get positive 5 volts from this terminal over here. Okay, now for your op amps and all, so when you are actually doing experiments with op amps, okay, we require a dual power supply. It requires a positive voltage as well as a negative voltage. So this is the third section of this power supply, where it is giving you positive voltage, okay, and negative voltage with respect to a ground. Okay, how do you set these voltages? It is through these three knobs. Okay, it is the same as what we have discussed over here. Okay, now for voltage, these are the two knobs, coarse and fine. okay, you can set the voltage accordingly. I will show you how to do, and for current you can vary this. Okay, so how do you use this? Okay, so what I do is that I turn on the power supply. I press, if I want to use this section, I have to press this button 30 volts over here. Okay, it will show you the voltage which is coming over here. Okay, so you can use a multimeter in voltage DC. See, now I have used a multimeter, and this is actually set to measure DC voltage. Okay, so what we do is that we take a multimeter. I am just checking how much is the voltage over here. It is showing 11.5 on the multimeter. On the power supply, it is showing 11.2. Okay, so you can actually vary this. Now if I want to set it to 15, just see, I am just varying the course. Okay, I am varying the course knob. Okay, so it is exactly at 15. Now if you want to set it fine, okay, so use this fine knob and set it exactly to 15. Okay, so this is positive, this is negative. Okay, so we have learned how to use this section. Okay, so it is very simple. This is positive, this is negative. Using this coarse and fine, you can set the voltage accordingly. Okay, now the second section, okay, there is no adjustment for that. It is a fixed 5 volt power supply. Maximum current is 1 amp. Okay, so if you connect a multimeter, you will get 4.97, that is 5 volts over here. Okay, maximum current it can give is 1 amp. Okay, here also maximum current that it can give is 1 amp. Okay, next is dual power supply. Okay, so if you want to set maybe 10 volts over here and minus 10 volt over here and with respect to ground, what you can do is that you can use this course. Okay, and you can actually set it up. Okay, so I just see the multimeter multimeter reading. It is showing 10. So how I actually varied this so that I got 10 over here. So I am getting plus 10 volts. Okay, on this probe or on this connector over here of the, I'm varying the fine. Okay, so I'm getting exact 10. Okay, so you can vary your fine to set it up. Okay, so I'm getting 10 volts on this. Okay, so if I want minus 10 volt, see, it will automatically be set. Okay, you need not do the setting here. Okay, so whatever is over here, voltage that you are setting, so positive voltage will be coming over here and negative voltage will be coming over here. So if you have plus 10 here, you will get minus 10 with respect to ground. Okay, and you can set your current level also, how much maximum you want. Maximum it can give you is 1 amp. Okay, so this is how we use a power supply. Okay, so thank you. Hi friends, in this particular video we'll learn how to use a function generator. So this is a function generator, and also we'll be learning how to use a CRO. Okay, so this is a CRO and this is a function generator. Now if you want to, if you have designed an amplifier, now for that amplifier you need to give an input signal, and then that input signal will go in the amplifier circuit, and then it will be amplified, and then it comes at the output. Okay, so this is the device that is actually giving the input signal. So this is the source for the amplifier. Okay, so from here we are getting the input signal. Now how to use this function generator? Okay, now the first thing is that now as you know that the input signal given to amplifier usually is a sine wave. Okay, and then in a sine wave we have amplitude part and we have the frequency part. Okay, so the amplitude part you can set it using these two knobs over here. So we have your amplitude, you can see here that it is written amplitude over here. So this is basically is used to set the amplitude of the input signal. Okay, and then these knobs are actually used to set the frequency of the input signal. So so the input signal that is there has amplitude and frequency. So this is used to set the amplitude or to vary the amplitude. And these buttons which are there, they are used to set the frequency with this multiplier switch. Okay, so it is very simple. Now, if you want to set the input signal for a frequency of 1 kilohertz, so what you can do is that you can actually press this button. Now, see here, you can see I am pressing this 1 kilo button over here, and this multiply knob, you can see this some indication is over here, and then 1 is over here. So it is actually multiplying. So 1k into 1 is 1 kilohertz. So you actually, if you connect this function generator to a CRO, you are expected to get a 1 kilohertz signal. Okay, if you want a 10k signal, then you have to press 10k, and this has to be 1. If you want 20k, there are two options. Either you press a 10k and you set this guy to 2, okay, so it is 10 into 2, or you press this 100k and set it to 0.2. so whichever you find convenient, you can use. Okay, so you have to only remember that for frequency, this buttons and this multiplier switch will play an important role. Okay, this is a multiplying thing. So 10k, so 10k into 2 will give you, this is a simple thing, 20 kilohertz. Okay, so this is how you vary the frequency, and then using this amplitude knob over here, this is how you vary the amplitude. Okay, now this is called as the CRO. Now using this device, what we did is that we gave input to the amplifier. Okay, the input signal went to the amplifier, it got amplified. Now we can't see using our naked eyes, correct? No, so we have to we use a device, something called as CRO, to actually see how my waveform is looking. Okay, so the output of the amplifier is actually connected to the CRO. Okay, and then your signal will be displayed onto the CRO. Okay, now if you see this, I'll not explain all the things, I will just explain what is required. So it has two channels, this is channel 1 and this is channel 2. Okay, so this you can actually see two signals over here. So in short, I can connect input over here to this channel, so I can see input also and output also of the amplifier at the same time. Okay, so there are two channels, channel 1 and channel 2. Okay, it is not compulsory that always input has to be connected to channel 1 and input output has to be connected to channel 2. You can connect wherever you want. Okay, they are independent channels. Okay, so this is the voltage division for channel 1, this is for channel 2, and this is for time division adjustment. Okay, I'll show you how it is. Okay, now if you want to see, now we have something called as BNC connector. Now these are called as BNC connectors. Okay, so this, if you can see here properly, they are called as BNC connectors. Now I'll just show you one properly. Okay, and this is just one simple BNC connector. So on one side it will have this knob, okay, that will either go here or here, and on the other side it has these crocodile pins. Okay, so what you can do is that, now if I want to connect, what I will do is that I will simply connect output of this function generator to this CRO and check how the signal is appearing. Okay, so what I can do is that, now we have three options here, 1, 2, and 3. Now which option you should use? Okay, so you have to always use this 50 ohms option. Okay, so you have to connect your probe BNC connector over here. Okay, so I connect it over here on one side. Okay, and I use one more BNC connector. I will use channel 2 in this case. You can use any channel that you like, there is no compulsion. And what I will do is that I will short these two I will short these two probes here. I have used wires. Okay, you can directly use crocodile pins, but I wanted to use that for a circuit, so I use wires. So it is like a same, it is like one connector now. Okay, positive to positive and negative to negative. Okay, so directly output of this function generator is given to this CRO here. Okay, so what is the first thing that you do? You turn this fellow, this function generator on. It is already on. You can see here. You can turn this on. Okay, now this is the new CRO. It will show you digital readings of channel 1, the setting of channel 1. So it is set to 10 millivolts, 5 millivolts. So you can change this accordingly depending on how much signal is getting displayed over here. If it is small, you can keep it small. If it is big, you can keep it high. Okay, and channel 2 is set for 2 volts. Okay, and your time division is set for 1 millisecond. Okay, so what is the first thing that you do? Okay, you always want when you are setting this up, both the devices, the first thing what you do is that you press this ground button. Okay, so you press this ground button, Okay, this line has to be exactly in the center. So using, now since I am using channel 2, this is the knob for that. Okay, okay. If I had to use channel 1, this is the knob for changing the thing. Okay, so I am pressing the ground button. I am releasing the ground button. Okay, and then we'll see what outcome we have might get. Okay, so you can see I am getting a proper sinusoidal waveform. Okay, now. Okay, so this is how the output, this how the signal looks like. So what I have done is that I have connected function generator directly to the CRO. Since now why it is little chubby is because of this grounding issues. Okay, if I had to connect this crocodile pins properly, the waveform will not. Okay, so if we have a new VNC connectors, this waveform will be stable enough. Okay, so this is how you do. We'll only learn how to use this. Forget about the waveform that is. Okay. Now, if I want to increase the amplitude, now you can. So, if you want to increase the amplitude, no. Okay. Now, so if I vary this, the signal looks to be big, but actually you are not increasing the amplitude of the signal. Okay. You are just making it big. Okay. If you actually want to increase the amplitude of the signal, what you have to do is you have to actually vary this knob. Okay, so you have to increase this. So if you vary this knob, you are actually increasing the amplitude. Okay, now we'll just measure. Okay, the amplitude with this setting. Now it is, how do you measure this? We'll measure half of this peak. So it is 1, 2, 3 divisions. Okay, 3 into channel 2 it is, no, so 2, so it is 6 volts. So this is 6 volts. Okay, so if I actually make it small, okay, it is actually 6 volt. So it is 1.2 into 5 volts is 6 volts. Okay, so when I vary this, it doesn't mean that the signal is becoming small. Okay, you are just zooming the signal. Okay, the signal is remaining same. Okay, so this is what it means. So actually the signal amplitude is 6 volts. Now if I actually reduce it from the function generator, okay, now you will measure. Now what I have done is that I am reducing the signal. Okay, now if you measure the signal amplitude, it is 1. So this is 1 into 2 is 2 volts. Now the amplitude of the signal, that is half wave, is 2 volts. Okay, so if I increase it, okay, so it is 2 into 1 is 2. So this is how we actually change the amplitude of the signal. Okay, now if I want to change the frequency, so I have pressed this 1k, and what I have to do is that this time base is very small, so I have to increase that. Okay, now we see how to vary the amplitude. Now you can see a proper signal. The problem with the previous waveform was the connector, so we have replaced the connectors. Okay, so what we do is that we press ground. We see that it is exactly at the center here. I have pressed ground C here, and then we vary this knob so that it, the line is exactly at the center. We release this. Okay, and then if you want to vary this, what we have to do is this button. Okay, so you can see X shift. Okay, this knob is to vary this in X direction. Okay, so what I am doing is that I am setting this, keeping this at this level. Okay, now how much is the amplitude? Now it is 1 box, 1 division, 2 divisions. So 2 into 1 is 2 volts. Okay, since I am using channel 2. Okay, now if I actually increase it like this, okay, so how many divisions it is now? 1, 2, 3, 4. So 4 into 0.5 is 2 again. Okay, so if I vary this, it doesn't amplify the signal. Okay, so this is something that you have to know. Okay, if it is big, it is not that it has amplified. Okay, if you have to actually increase the amplitude of the signal, you have to actually vary this knob on the function generator. So I will decrease it. Okay, if I decrease it, okay, now what will be the amplitude of the signal? So it is 1 into 1 is 1 volt. Okay, now what I will do is that I will increase this guy so that, okay, so it is 2 divisions into 0.5 is still 1 volt. Okay, so this is how you vary the amplitude. So to vary the amplitude, you have to vary this. Okay, to vary the frequency, you have to vary this. Okay, you have to press this button, and so this is now for 5 kilohertz. So I press 10 and I will set is, I'll keep this at 0.5. So this waveform that you can see is 5 kilohertz signal. Okay, so this waveform that you can see is 5 kilohertz signal. Okay, so if you want a sinusoidal waveform, okay, you press this. Okay, so if you want a square waveform, you press this button. Okay, so if you see here, you are actually getting a square waveform. Okay, and these vertical lines are not seen. Okay, in CRO you will not see. Okay, so it is like this. Okay, so this is a square waveform at 5 kilohertz. So if I press this button, it is a triangular waveform. Okay, triangular waveform of 5 kilohertz. Okay, so using these three buttons, you can actually set a signal for a sinusoidal, for a square, and for a triangular waveform. And using these knobs, you can actually set it for the frequency and with this frequency multiplier. So I guess this is just a basic introduction of how to use your devices. We will be requiring these devices when we perform our experiments. Okay? So thank you very much. Hi friends, okay, now this was the first experiment that we had done. It was current series feedback amplifier, okay, and then we had tried to find out what is the voltage over here, okay, and then we checked the output of this amplifier with the feedback and without feedback, okay. So when the capacitor was there, it was like there was no feedback, okay, and then when we had to remove this capacitor from the circuit, there was a feedback, and that was the reason the output was decreasing heavily. That we have seen properly in the experiment number one. Okay, now we'll be learning about voltage series feedback amplifier. It is the circuit for voltage series feedback amplifier is same as what is for current series feedback amplifier. The only difference is your output is taken across the emitter over here. Okay, in the previous case the output was taken across the capacitor, across the collector. Now here we are taking output across the emitter. Now if you as I already discussed in the theory, okay, now this particular circuit is used as an emitter follower. Okay, it is very famous circuit that is used. Okay, now what is the emitter follower? The output follows the input. So if you actually connect the circuit, okay, if you give an input over here, if you take an output over here, you will find that input is equal to output. Okay, so then what is the use of this circuit? Now this particular circuit has very high input impedance and very low output impedance, so that is the reason we use emitter followers in many of the circuits. Okay, so the circuit actually is the same that we have done for our first experiment. Only the output is only the place where we are taking the output changes. Okay, at the emitter. So we come here. So this is the same circuit that we have done in the first experiment. Okay. Now what we have to do is I'll just explain. This is emitter. This is emitter, this is base, and this collector. This is the same first circuit, it is same dot. Okay, so what we'll do is that we'll just turn it on and we'll see. Okay, so we'll turn on the power supply. Just turn on the power supply. Okay, so we have set it to 12 volts. Okay, I'll give some input. Yes, I have given some input via function generator. Okay, I'm not changing it, and I'm turning on the CRO. Okay, what I've done is that I've used two channels, okay, one to see the input, one to check the output. I've connected channel 2 to the emitter, and channel 1 I've connected to the input over here. So these two points I'm checking, okay, this is one point, this point, and this point, okay. Now we'll see what comes, okay. So see, I have put it in dual mode. Okay, so in emitter follower, what will happen is that inputs will follow the output. Okay, so if you see these two waveforms, they are exactly same. Okay, so one is output waveform, this is output waveform, this is input waveform. Now if you see them, okay, they are actually exactly same. Okay, so this is what you need to learn in this voltage series feedback amplifier concept, that it is it works as an emitter follower where the gain is 1 and your input is exactly replica of, or your output is exactly replica of the input. Okay, so this is why we require this. Okay, थैंक यू वेरी मच.